From the News Channel 5 Network, this is Medical Mondays.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Medical Monday. We have a wonderful show for you ahead, especially if you need some help when it comes to hearing. I have Dr. David Gnewikow with me from Advanced Hearing Solutions. Dr. Gnewikow, thanks for being back.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
It's always good to have you. And I was thinking about the show tonight, and I was thinking, you know, families are gathering. It is the holidays. You know, jokes will be told about dad or mom who can't hear anymore.
Right.
But they will also bring up the issue of someone who cannot hear in the family.
Right. So what's funny is we always get a pretty big influx of new patients in January. And I feel like there's one of two things. I think sometimes people actually make their New Year's resolutions of, okay,
yes,
I'm going to finally do something about my hearing. But I think a lot of it is exactly what you just said. It's that it's easier to ignore hearing loss if my life is sort of quiet or if I live at home, you know, with not a big group. Mm-hmm. But when we get in these big groups, that's when it gets more challenging. Background noise, children's voices. And those are the things that we love. And so a lot of times that's a push for somebody to come see us and get some help.
And I asked you before the show, you got holiday hours? He said, I'm going to be there this week.
That's right. So our office is actually open throughout the holidays with the exception of Christmas Eve and Christmas Day and New Year's Day. So there will be somebody. I'm going to take a couple days off, but my staff is going to be there. I'll give them some other days off.
That sounds fair enough. Let's hear about your office. Tell me about it.
Okay, so we're located in Mount Juliet. We are right off the interstate on North Mount Juliet Road, so it's about 7/10 of a mile from I-40 at the Mount Juliet exit. That's exit 226. We've been in business for 12 years, been taking care of folks in Mount Juliet, but we have people come from all over, lots of Middle Tennessee, Alabama, Kentucky. We're honored that people come to see us from a long way away. Our office is really convenient. Mm-hmm. You park right at the front door, walk right in. So it's not too hard to get to, even if you have to drive just a little ways to get there.
You were telling me about a patient that you have down in Alabama.
That's right.
Who has been a faithful patient, but then has told a bunch of other people in Alabama who now come to you.
So he must be very influential because he originally came to me through a referral of another audiologist and said, I've been several places and, you know, not very pleased with, and you know, I'm kind of testing mm-hmm. you out. And he's actually a rocket scientist. That's what he does.
A legit
rocket scientist. So if you get the stamp of approval, the seal
yes.
of approval from a rocket scientist, that must be really good. But he must be extremely influential because people come all the time from Alabama just based on his recommendations.
Well, that's very flattering.
Thank you. Keep them coming.
By the way, I should mention, we are taking your phone calls tonight. If you have a question about hearing aids or hearing loss, give us a call, 615-737-PLUS. We will get those answers tonight. Dr. Gnewikow is great about that and making it simple. First of all, tell me, what causes hearing loss?
Okay, so two biggest causes of hearing loss. Number one, people are going to think I'm going to say noise is number one, mm-hmm. but noise is not number one. Genetics is number one.
Oh.
So, you know, naturally, we'll talk in a minute about noise. Noise can affect hearing loss, and I think a lot of times people think, well, I worked in a factory, or, you know, I've never worked in a factory. I should never have hearing loss. I've never done anything bad for my hearing. But certainly genetics can be a very big factor. Noise is probably number two. That is, working in loud environments, doing loud stuff. I'm an outdoorsman, so I've been around machinery and chainsaws and shotguns and those mm-hmm. type of things can certainly have some detrimental effect. Those are number one and number two. There's lots of other factors that can kind of come in. Overall health, viruses, different things can cause actual malformations in the inner ear or in the middle ear can cause hearing loss, but genetics number one, noise number two.
So on the flip side of that, if for those of us who think we at least have good hearing right now,
right.
how can we preserve our hearing? Is there anything we can actually do?
Sure. So two things I'll say. One is a definite and two is a maybe.
Okay.
So definitely anything we can do to protect our hearing from excessive noise exposure is going to have a beneficial outcome for us. So I just mentioned outdoors. I see the set of Southern Woods and Waters
yes.
over there. It's hunting season.
Mm-hmm.
I'm an outdoorsman. Lots of friends that do that. And I am amazed at how few people take steps to protect their hearing in that environment. And absolutely, positively, that can be detrimental to hearing. Simple things like tractors, chainsaws, and again, I'm a realist. I don't yell at people about wearing hearing protection, but long-term exposure to those type of things, hearing loss can be prevented from mm-hmm. those things. We can't change our genetics, but we can affect how much noise we're exposed to. So that's number one. The second thing I'll say, and this is not, I don't have scientific data on this yet. There's sort of some preliminary research going on that talks about antioxidants and prevention of hearing loss. So we know what antioxidants are. Mm-hmm. They're recommended all the time. It's eating good things like nuts and blueberries and cranberry, mm-hmm. those type of things. There is a lot of evidence starting to appear in the research that says basically being healthy, eating healthy, antioxidants can have some preventative effect on hearing loss. Now, I wish I could say, well, you just need to take vitamin D and vitamin C and do this, and we don't have that research yet. Mm-hmm. But what I'm recommending to my patients is just what every doctor is. A healthy lifestyle, a healthy diet certainly can have some significant positive impacts on hearing as well.
And when it comes to buying hearing protection, are there things that you should look for?
Oh, wow. We may spend the whole rest of our show talking about
this. Okay, I didn't know I opened such a can of worms.
So it depends on what activity you are involved mm-hmm. in. You know, simple foam earplugs, they're very cheap. Yep. You can get them at Walmart, you can get them in an outdoor store, you can buy them online. If they are used correctly, are very effective. And the good thing about foam earplugs is that they're pretty hard to mess up. You squeeze them down really tight, you put them deep in the ear, they expand, and they tend to do a pretty good job. Those are good for, you know, mild to moderate levels of mm-hmm. noise. So that's what I use when I'm driving a tractor, or I've got a loud lawnmower and I got to mow an acre. So that's what I use, or a weed eater, those type of things. There are a lot more sophisticated types of hearing protection out there as well. So there are things that are called active hearing protection. For example, we've talked a little bit about outdoors and shooting. I use some products when I'm hunting where I can actually hear. It's like a hearing aid, but it shuts off when you shoot the gun. And there's some really neat stuff out there for you outdoorsmen. You can check out our website, send us an email, whatever. I'd be glad to kind of to go into that a little bit of detail. Also, there are earmuffs. So the mm-hmm. bigger, those tend to give a little bit more protection, but they're a little bit more cumbersome to wear. Lots of people don't want to do that. In fact, I have a colleague who's an audiologist who is, I was actually talking to him today, and he said, oh man, I'm driving down the road, I'm watching a construction crew saw concrete, and he said they've all got their hearing protection on top of their head, you know, and that's the world that us audiologists live in. We think about stuff like that. So I would say just generically across the board, the cheap foam earplugs do a really good job, but we can do custom molds and get into this active protection mm-hmm. as well, which is very good for some people.
Also, tell me about audiology.
Okay.
What should someone expect to find if they are going for a consult on their hearing loss or to have a hearing aid?
Okay. All right. So there are really two types of professionals that do hearing aid fitting, hearing aid sales, hearing aid evaluations. One is an audiologist, which is what I do. I have another audiologist in my practice. Both of us have a doctorate mm-hmm. in audiology specifically. So 4 years of college, 4 years of post college. I also did like 7 years because I got a PhD because I was really asking for it, or I wanted to goof off a little bit longer. Hope my wife is not watching this show. So an audiologist is university trained specifically to do what we do. There are also what are called hearing instrument specialists. Hearing instrument specialists has a little bit less college training. Usually it is learning under somebody else that is doing the same type of thing. Regardless of who you see, your question of what you should expect mm-hmm. is really important. So the first thing I would say is expect somebody to listen to what you have to say. And I think that's true whether you're seeing an audiologist or your primary care doctor or anybody. You want a doctor that's going to sit down and listen to what the problem is. We start all of our conversations with new patients with, tell us why you're here. Not let me go through your symptoms, not let me tell me if you've ever worn hearing aids. It's, I want to understand why that person is in my office. There are so many factors. We were just talking about the holidays and people hearing in the family. There are so many factors that lead up to somebody making the call and coming in to see the audiologist. And usually, unfortunately, there are 5 to 7 years of thinking about it. In fact, that's what the national average is. I'm hoping you people listening tonight don't wait 7 years. But the national average is 5 to 7 years of sort of identifying, yes, I have a hearing problem, before they actually come to see an audiologist. And the reason that we ask those questions and we say, tell me about why you're here, is because that's what that process should be like. It should not be something that is scary. It should not be something that is intimidating. It absolutely should not be something that is a sales pitch or high pressure. And I'll just say this, if your experience with hearing aids, with a hearing doctor or a hearing instrument specialist has been about pressure for you to buy something, you need to seek a second opinion. Because our job is to explain how we can help, explain what people should expect, really explain both the positives and negatives. There are very good things that we do with hearing aids to help people, but there are also negative parts of that experience or things that they need to be prepared and understand. So really somebody that's gonna listen, but somebody that's gonna fully explain the whole story,
right,
not just the good, and say, hey, here's something that you need to buy.
Perfect. I feel like I'm peppering you with questions.
Oh, that's okay.
I'm sure you get it all day long. So I want to invite you again to call in with your questions about hearing loss and hearing aids. We will get those answered tonight. 615-737-PLUS is the number to call. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll come right back.